President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. says the Philippines is done with the International Criminal Court after Junk Manila's latest appeal.
The chief executive heading for a state visit to Malaysia a day after his second State of the Nation address on Monday.
General Romeo Bronner formally takes his place as the new chief of staff of the Armed Forces of the Philippines.
And Ukraine seeking the restoration of the Black Sea grain deal to avert another global food crisis.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Crow.
And I'm Denise Insai.
You're watching Top Story. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. reaffirms the Philippine government's stance it will no longer communicate with the International Criminal Court. Marcos spoke Friday at the sidelines of the launch of a new road project in Mindanao. The ICC rejected Manila's plea this week against resuming its probe into the Duterte drug war. Marcos says with no appeals pending, the government's dealings with the ICC have come to an end. General Romeo Bronner formally assumes the post as the Chief of Staff of the Armed Forces of the Philippines. Bronner replaced General Andres Centeno at the AFP Change of Command and Retirement Ceremony led by President Marcos this afternoon. The new AFP Chief thanked Marcos for his appointment and vowed his steadfast loyalty and absolute commitment to the Constitution.
Internally, we will focus on making sure that we have a solid and professional armed forces of the Philippines. All members of the AFP, whether they are officers, enlisted personnel, or civilian human resource, should follow the chain of command. Externally, we will help unite our communities. We will make sure that the former rebels unite once again with their families, as we extend our hands in reconciliation.
Marcos, for his part, expressed his gratitude to retired General Centeno for empowering the AFP. The president urged the armed forces to work towards an AFP that is agile and prepared for any contingency.
As your commander-in-chief, I assure you that this administration is firm in reinforcing this noble pursuit by modernizing the AFP. Along with our efforts to strengthen our external defense capabilities, I ask you too to continue working with national government agencies and civilian stakeholders to form an archipelagic consciousness amongst Filipinos.
The outgoing Chief of Staff of the Armed Forces says a leadership change in the military was triggered by the need to focus more on protecting Philippine waters. General Andres Centeno is set to take on a new role as a presidential advisor on the West Philippine Sea. He aims to formulate a new strategy in dealing with maritime tensions with China.
Our leadership has deemed it important na mabigyan ng focus and importance yung the way we address the issues there in a bigger scale. And that's why they thought of creating an office of the presidential advisor. It will be a combination or a mix of everything that we can do. It doesn't have to be military alone. It has to be a combination of efforts. That's why the task force would most likely be interagency, meaning there will be inclusion among other agencies to compose the task force.
Manila's Defense Secretary says the Philippines is keeping a close eye on Taiwan amid the threat of an invasion from China. Secretary Teodoro says government is preparing contingencies related to that possibility, as well as other conflicts in the region.
First and foremost, we really have to make an assessment whether such is likely or not. Nonetheless, we continue to plan on all contingencies, not merely any flashpoint between China and Taiwan. But any contingency within the theater. And it's a multi-agency effort, not only the defense effort. That is a thing that we continue to monitor daily. And hopefully the engagements bilaterally between the United States and China leads to the diffusion of tensions in that theater.
China has been claiming Taiwan as its own territory despite the island's strong objections. It has increasingly entered Taiwan's airspace in recent years and has exerted pressure on countries to sever ties with the island. China is not ruling out the use of force to bring Taiwan under its control.
Other news, Senator Amy Marcos thanks the Supreme Court for dismissing the over 1 billion peso ill-gotten wealth case against her family. The senator, who is the elder sister of President Marcos, spoke to the media during a visit to El Salvador, or El Salvador, Misamis Oriental. The High Court earlier this week affirmed the dismissal of the case, citing insufficient evidence. Economic recovery and poverty alleviation remain the Marcos administration's top priority. Measures meant to address these issues have yet to hurdle Congress and the Senate. RG Cruz with a special report.
This is Norma Abacan. She's on her way to a local fishmonger to get their meal for the day. She's going to split her purchase with her husband, a freelance driver. They live just steps away from the seat of the country's House of Representatives, where President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. is set to deliver his second State of the Nation address. Norma sells beauty products to augment her husband's income so they can cope with inflation.
Sa ngayon, ano, racket, direct selling. As po, yung bigas po, tsaka yung isda, lahat naman po tumaas, kaya lang sana mapababa.
Controlling inflation remains the top national concern of a majority of Filipinos, according to Pulse Asia's latest survey. It's also the one issue where the respondents said the Marcos administration fared most poorly.
Doon sa increase ng paid ng workers, doon sa dalawa pang usapin, lalo na yung pinakamahalaga, yung mataas na presyo ng bilihin, hati ang Pilipino. One-third ang approving, one-third ang undecided, at higit sa one-third ang disapproving. So ibig sabihin, karamihan ng mga Pilipino ay parang hindi sila nasisiyahan doon sa aprobado, doon sa pagtugon ng administrasyon sa dalawang usapin na ito, kahirapan at mataas na presyo ng bilihin.
Senate President Miguel Zubiri says the economy and uplifting the lives of the impoverished remain the priorities of the administration, as seen in the 20 priority bills targeted for enactment by both the House and the Senate by year-end. Most of the bills have already hurdled the House but are languishing in the Senate.
It's almost about 44 measures. Pero yung pinangako namin na may pasa namin hopefully by December of 2023, is about 20. Sayang ang momentum natin. This year, 2022 to 2023, we're looking at 6.5 growth, GDP growth rate. Ang gusto po natin Pangulo, by middle of his term, by 2025, baka makaabot na tayo ng 8% growth rate, which I think is phenomenal. So, phenomenal sa buong region. Talaga magaling yan. Magandang numero yan. Tayo siguro ang pinaka-darling pagdating sa GDP growth rate sa ating region, Southeast Asia.
Before the 19th Congress adjourned its first regular session last June, only six out of the then 42 priority bills got the nod of the country's bicameral legislature. The Senate chief believes most of his colleagues will vote for the unfinished priorities.
Meron lang may kukonta na mas na, nakikita ko na medyo substantial would probably be the mandatory ROTC, kasi meron din from the majority na ayaw. But the others, I presume that they are happy bills. Even the MUP, you know, yung ating pension ng ating mga sundalo at kapulisan, madugo yan. I feel that within the Senate itself, we can get the majority support of that. Kasi long term, pag tinignan mo yung long term situation, lalong lalala ang ating fiscal position pag hindi po natin na-actionan yan. Dahil as of today, yung buwis, binabayaran mong buwis, binabayaran kong buwis at lahat ng mga kababayan natin, yun pong ginagamit natin para sa pensyon ng sundalo at kapulisan. May mga madugo pero sa tingin ko papasa din.
Senate President Pro Tempore Loren Legarda, however, explains the process won't be simple and it will depend on many factors.
Legislating any measure is a complex, arduous process that involves consultations, negotiations, sometimes even compromises. The extent to which these bills will be easy or difficult to enact will depend on many factors, like the level of support and cooperation from not just the Senate, but both chambers of Congress, even the alignment of interests and advocacies among lawmakers, and the overall political climate.
A protracted debate is also inevitable.
Differing opinions and finding a common ground is essential in advancing the president's agenda and achieving meaningful results.
A political expert, however, says beyond working on unfinished priorities, the administration must also zero in on making sure the country's national budget is properly spent, as this is key to making sure all programs are implemented well.
Sabi na rin yan, pero I would argue na kailangan ng more effective governance mechanisms. Aside from the budget modernization, hindi natututukan yung performance. Kailangan din palakasin yung congressional oversight during budget implementation. After all, sila yung nag-approve ng budget. Having said that, baka kailangan rin magkaroon ng congressional voice at the very start of the budget process.
Dr. Magno also says the public must have a greater voice in crafting the budget and the government must employ new and emerging technologies such as artificial intelligence to improve the delivery of government services. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
The education sector lays out its demands for President Marcos ahead of his SONA. A teachers group urging the president to raise their entry-level salary to 50,000 pesos. Alliance of Concerned Teachers Chair Vladimir Cueta says granting a salary hike is just a matter of political will. Non-teaching personnel also urging the government to triple their entry-level salaries to 33,000 pesos.
Tatandaan natin na ngayong panahong ito, taong ito ay huling taon na ng SSL5, no? Pero tuloy-tuloy ang pagtaas at sirit ng presyo ng bilihin, no? Yung buwis ay tuloy-tuloy. Kaya yung panawagan ng pagtaas ng sahod o nakabubuhay na sahod, no, ay kailangan talagang itulak ito lalo pa sa panahong ito, no?
President Marcos set to make a three-day state visit to Malaysia a day after his second State of the Nation address. The Foreign Affairs Department says a state visit will be from July 25 to the 27th. Marcos will be meeting with Malaysia's king as well as its prime minister, Anwar Ibrahim. The DFA adds the president and his economic team will be advancing Manila and Kuala Lumpur's bilateral trade. Investment pledges also expected during the visit.
This reciprocal visit between the leaders of both countries in 2023 is a testament to the reinvigorated relationship between the Philippines and Malaysia. It is also timely as the Philippines and Malaysia will mark 60th anniversary of the establishment of diplomatic relations between the two countries.
Marcos will also meet with the Filipino community in Malaysia to share the government's plans for migrant workers.
Vietnam assures the Philippines its rice export to the country will continue despite woes arising from the El Nino. Hanoi's envoy to Manila spoke Friday at a business matching event of the Vietnamese embassy. Ambassador Huang Huy Chung says the Philippines will remain among Vietnam's key destinations for rice exports. Hanoi's rice shipment to the Philippines in the first half of 2023 is up more than 4% from last year.
Every year we export rice to the Philippines about 2 million tons of rice for the medium class of people. I remember that during the COVID-19, At that time, Vietnam, our Prime Minister assured to the Philippines that we ensure the rice security for the Philippines. And you know that Vietnam, we are strong in agricultural products, especially rice. We shall ensure the Philippines that we shall export rice to the Philippines from now on when you need.
Residents of Pola Town in Oriental Mindoro now allowed to fish again. The fishing ban was lifted in the whole province 5 months after a massive oil spill. However, Pola Mayor Jennifer Cruz says swimming in Pola's waters is still banned due to the presence of tar balls and remaining grease. She adds a local government has yet to receive the water control test results from the Philippine Fisheries Bureau.
Waiting nga sa result ng D4. Wala pa kasi sa local government. Ang pinanghawakan pa lang natin right now is yung kanilang sinabi na safe na. Pero yung papers at yung talagang test ng water control na water na oil and grease and other tests ng Pola water, wala pa sa amin. So waiting kami dito. Okay. Hindi pa kasi kami full recovery and nandun kami sa recovery process. Habang na doon kami, kaya lang may oil spill pa nga, hindi na lang siya talaga mapapunta yung mga turista.
Water concessionaires Maynilad and Manila Water will be relying on their deep well facilities to augment supply amid the El Nino phenomenon. Alvin El Chico with the details.
Some areas in Quezon City, San Juan, and San Mateo Rizal are set to experience a six-hour water interruption from Thursday night to early Friday morning. But Manila Water clarifies this is due to maintenance work.
Kadalasan natatapos naman ito ng siguro mga 3 to 4 hours. Pero binibigyan natin ng panahon para mag-build up yung pressure. Kaya nilalagay na natin ng 6 hours. Sigurado naman na bago o pagdating ng alas 4 ng madaling araw ay okay na.
Maynilad customers meanwhile can rest easy as no water interruption is projected until next week as long as the rains continue over the watershed. The water level in Angat Dam has barely moved in the last 2 days as the MWSS voluntarily reduced its allocation to 39 cubic meters per second due to excess water from Ipo Dam.
The worst case po, no, ay if ever hindi natin ma-receive yung mga ulan this weekend, papabay Wednesday or Thursday, titingnan natin ay doon magpapalik po yung interruption natin. The best case naman po, if ever po napatanggap po natin ang ulan, ituloy-tuloy po na walang interruption for the next 2 weeks po.
The MWSS plans to invite the Dumaga tribe of Angat to do another rain dance soon.
Gumagana. It's worked naman eh. Nakita mo naman, Alvin. Rain dance kami nung Monday. Pagdating ng Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, ay nagulan naman tayo.
Meanwhile, the concessionaires are ready with their deep wells to augment the water supply in the capital. This deep well facility near UP Diliman, developed by Manila Water, can produce 1.2 million liters per day.
Kaya natin binubuksan ng deep wells is to ensure na kapag nagkaroon ng water crisis is dapat merong unlimited and potable water supply 24/7 para sa mga tao. 400 service connections na po yung nasusupply natin for a 1.2 million liters per day.
Maynilad, on the other hand, has constructed this deep well in Fairview, Quezon City.
This deep well po, around 100 water service connections po yung masusuplayan niya. Since 24 hours pa po yung supply nitong area, so in case po na magkaroon ng interruptions, doon po namin siya pinapagana.
According to the MWSS, Manila Water has 49 operational deep wells, while Maynilad has 7. But the government clarifies these deep wells will not be used continuously.
Kailangan po natin pahingain yung groundwater para ho mag-recharge siya. Kasi po pag continuous po ito na nagbobomba, siyempre po yung tubig sa ilalim ng lupa, bababa po yon hanggang sa baka dumating ang punto na wala na mahigop.
According to experts, the government regulates the use of deep wells as it can cause land collapse or sinkholes once the underground water is depleted. Alvin El Chico, ABS-CBN News.
Passengers of the LRT1 now enjoying its modern trains that were launched Thursday, with the management promising to give their customers a more comfortable ride. Jackie Manabat reports.
One of the train sets purchased from Spain in 2017 has started running on the revenue line on Thursday on Metro Manila's oldest urban railway, the LRT1. Passengers instantly noticed better air conditioning inside the train compared to the older units.
Sa aircon, meron yung luma, kasi ngayon wala ni. Masarap sakyan ngayon. Malamig. Naranasan ko talaga na mahabang pila, na nagkasiksikan sa loob ng train, pero okay lang naman.
According to the Light Rail Manila Corporation, the private company which maintains and operates the LRT Line 1, it's not your usual air conditioning equipment.
The temperature inside the train adjusts to the volume of people inside. So may parang automatic yung kanyang sensor that detects adjust to the crowd volume. Mas, I can say na mas modern yung systems.
The new train also has a space for PWDs, signaling system that allows for smoother ride, and a high-tech console that allows the driver to immediately determine the cause of any glitches. The first batch of the same train sets, or the fourth-generation units, delivered to Manila in 2021, had problems with water leaking from air conditioning units. It also gets worse when it rains. The Department of Transportation admitted the issue early this year, but the operator assured the public that the Spain-made train set and the additional units coming in the next few weeks will have no water leaks, as these have gone through rigorous tests.
Ongoing yung fixes, no, to address the water leak issue. The trains are being repaired in batches, no, dahil natapos na yung first batch. Kaya ngayon ay nagamit na namin yung isang train, and then actually in August, first week noon, may madadagdag kami na isa pang train. So ito po ay gradually being repaired para makadeploy kami unti-unti.
More passengers can look forward to a more comfortable riding experience. The same trains will also be used for the LRT1 Cavite Extension project in the future. The LRMC also says they will not retire all of the Belgium-made Generation 1 trains, which have been running for the past 4 decades. The company says 48 trains will still be used to temporarily augment existing trains amid the expected doubling of passenger volume upon the completion of the LRT Line 1 extension from Baclaran down to Bacoor, Cavite. Jackie Manabat, ABS-CBN News.
The Information and Communications Technology Department says there will be no more extension of the July 25 SIM registration deadline. Jackie Pascual joins us on the line for more. Jackie?
Hi, Denise. Good afternoon. Department of Information and Communications Technology Secretary Ivan John Uy asserted that there will be no more extension for the SIM registration period, which ends on Tuesday, July 25. Uy said that majority, or about 99%, of active SIM users, or what they call the revenue-generating SIMs, have already been registered. In total, there are over 160 million SIMs in the country, but he says that they do not expect that the total number of registrants, as many SIMs are no longer in use. He added that those whose SIM is not registered will automatically be deactivated after the deadline, or around 12:01 a.m. of July 26. Deactivated SIMs, meanwhile, will have 5 days to register it after the deadline. He also warned that tech scams will continue to rise in the last days leading to the deadline, and that scammers are now shifting to other platforms. DICT reports over 104 million SIMs have already been registered as of July 20. Smart recorded over 49 million SIMs registered. Globe has over 47 million, while Dito has more than 7 million registered SIMs so far. And that's the latest. Back to you, Denise.
Thanks, Jackie.
The Philippine government launches a new program aimed at addressing the shortage of nurses in the country. Joyce Balancho reports.
The Commission on Higher Education, the Department of Health, and the Private Sector Advisory Council signed on Wednesday a joint administrative order for a program that will provide review classes for aspiring nurses. CHED Chairperson Prospero De Vera says the program will be for those who had failed the nursing licensure exam and are currently being employed as nursing aide or medical staff in hospitals.
Mobilize on the part of CHED yung magagaling na mga pamantasa na magbigay ng review classes para doon sa mga employed sa public and private hospitals para maipasa nila yung licensure test.
The hospitals will endorse the names of their staff who are qualified for the program. Private hospitals will shoulder the cost of the review for their staff, but CHED says it can also provide subsidy should the expenses reach a high amount. For those coming from public hospitals, the government will shoulder the financial requirements.
Idisenyo natin na ganun yun, no? Para hindi sila kailangang tumigil magtrabaho, para magabayan sila. So sa susunod na licensure test, hopefully, kung marami ang mag-a-apply dito, ay madadagdagan ng mga nurses.
The Department of Health sees this program as one of the measures to address the shortage of nurses in the country. Health Secretary Ted Herbosa says, while there are 500 licensed nurses in the Philippines, only half of them are servicing our hospitals. The other half are either working abroad or employed in other industries.
I'm talking about the Philippine General Hospital where I came from. Talagang may nurse to patient ratio kaming sinusunod. Usually yung mga 1:5 yan sa ward at 1:2 sa emergency at saka sa ICU. Pero doon nadinig nyo sinabi ko 1:30, 30, isang buong ward hawak ng isang nurse.
10 higher education institutions have signified their intention to join the review program. Included are the University of the Philippines, Manila, University of Santo Tomas, and Our Lady of Fatima University. CHED says the program will begin once the list of endorsements from hospitals and the number of participating schools have been finalized. Joyce Balanzo, ABS-CBN News.
Up next, India soaks fears of further food inflation after banning rice exports.
And a rosy outlook seen for the global IPO market. More news when we return.
Watching top story here again are the headlines. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. says the Philippines is done with the International Criminal Court after Junta Manila's latest appeal.
The chief executive heading for a state visit to Malaysia a day after his second State of the Nation address on Monday.
General Romeo Bronner formally takes his place as the new chief of staff of the Armed Forces of the Philippines.
And Ukraine seeking the restoration of the Black Sea grain deal to avert another global food crisis.
Ukraine finding ways to restore the Black Sea grain deal. The Ukrainian Foreign Minister Dmytro Kuleba said the initiative is needed to address global food insecurity. The Black Sea grain deal expired Monday after Russia withdrew. This is despite a UN offer to President Vladimir Putin to reconnect a Russian bank to the SWIFT international payment system in return for an extension of the grain agreement. The UN estimates a grain deal lowered food prices globally by 20%. Within days of withdrawing from that deal, Russia attacked the Ukrainian port of Kornomorsk, which destroyed 60,000 tons of wheat destined for China.
A local group of floor millers says Russia's termination of its grain deal with Ukraine won't be felt just yet here in the Philippines. The Philippine Association of Floor Millers says the country has a buffer stock of wheat good for 90 days. But it notes there could be indirect effects from Russia's move in the long run.
Mangyayari kung mababawasan o mawawala ang trigo galing sa Ukraine na papuntang North Africa at itong mga Middle Eastern countries. Oh. Itong mga bansang ito, hahanap naman ng ibang sources. So, ang sources na available, yung kinukuhaan natin. US, Canada, Australia, and so on. So, ang mangyayari, yung binibili natin, bibili na rin nila. Okay. Iagaw sila dun sa supply natin.
India orders a halt to its largest rice export category in a move that will roughly halve shipments by the world's largest exporter of the grain. The government says it was imposing a ban on non-basmati white rice as retail rice prices climbed 3% in a month after heavy monsoon rains caused significant damage to crops. India accounts for more than 40% of world rice exports. And low inventories with other exporters mean any cut in shipments could inflate food prices already driven up by Russia's invasion of Ukraine. The move now triggering fears of further inflation on global food markets.
More on India's bad weather. The death toll from the massive landslide that hit Maharashtra state rises to 16. Rescue operations have been paused amid heavy rains and fog. Around 100 people are believed to be still trapped under the mud. The slopes, soaked by overnight rains, gave way as residents slept.
North Korea threatens nuclear retaliation over America's deployment of aircraft carriers and submarines in South Korea. That's according to a report by the state media, citing the country's defense minister, who also accused Washington and Seoul of escalating tensions in the region. Now, his comments came days after an American soldier crossed into North Korea. The Pentagon revealed Pyongyang has not been answering calls over Private Travis King's condition.
Our priority focus and what the secretary reiterated at the beginning of this week was that we want to bring him home. We don't know his condition. We don't know where he's being held. We don't know the status of his health, but we are working with the interagency through the DOD, through the NSC and state, really pulling all levers of government here to try and find out.
Weather Bureau Pagasa is giving updates on Tropical Depression Egay. Let's listen in.
Pangalawang tropical cyclone bulletin na po ito, nagpalabas tayo nung una kaninang alas 11 ng umaga. So dito sa latest satellite imagery animation natin, makikita natin malayo pa yung sentro or maging yung kabuuan ng bagyong si Egay sa kalupaan ng ating bansa. At kanina alas 4, ito ay tinatayang nasa layong 835 kilometers ang layo east-southeast ng southeastern Luzon. Taglay ni Egay, ang lakas ng hangin umabot hanggang 55 kilometers per hour. Tropical depression intensity po ito, no? At yung pagbugso abot ng 70 kilometers per hour. Kumikilos sa direksyong west-northwest sa bilis naman na 20 kilometers per hour. So bagamat malayo pa ito sa kalupa na ating bansa, ay minabuti na po natin yung gawin yung lagi nating ginagawa, magbigay ng paunang abiso para mapaghanda nitong paparating na bagyo. Samantala dito nga sa may bandang kanlurang bahagi na ating bansa, may habagat po tayo or southwest monsoon. So sa pinaka-latest forecast track ng PAGASA makikita natin, ito yung analysis natin, location ng tropical depression na si Egay kaninang alas 2 ng hapon at bukas ng umaga, ito yung nasa nating position or location niya, 860 kilometers east ng southeastern Luzon. And then sa darating naman na linggo ng umaga, ito ay tinatayang, or linggo ng hapon, ito ay tinatayang nasa layang 705 kilometers east ng Infanta, Quezon. So mapansin natin from tropical depression intensity na estimate natin ngayon, ay posible itong maging storm, severe tropical storm, and by Sunday nga ay typhoon category, no? And then sa Lunes ng hapon, mapapansin natin, no, malayo pa rin dito sa kalupaan na ating bansa, tinatayang nasa layang 590 kilometers east ng Baler Aurora. At sa darating naman na Martes ng hapon, alas 2, nandito siya sa 405 kilometers east ng Calayan, Cagayan. Pagdating naman ng Miyerkules ng hapon, ito ay tinatayang nating nasa layang 260 kilometers north-northeast ng Itbayat, Batanes. So mapapansin natin yung tinatayang movement ng sentro ng bagyo sa ngayon hindi po natin inasang tatama sa landmass ng ating bansa. Pero pansinin natin, no, yung area of probability, hindi natin nirurule out yung posibilidad na pwedeng may mahagip itong bahagi ng ating bansa, particular na dito sa northeastern part nga ng Northern Luzon. Kaya't yung abiso natin, ngayon pa lamang po, dapat manatiling nakatutok sa 6-hourly update ng PAGASA hinggil nga sa tropical depression na si Egay. So climatologically speaking, baka nagtataka po kayo, ano ba yung mga naging historical na bagyo for the month of July? No, makikita natin may mga iba't ibang naging possible track. And yung nakikita natin na closest so far ay itong bagyong si Ising, which happened in 1991. Pero hindi nga natin nirurule out yung possibility gaya yung pinakita natin doon sa area probability na posibleng may mahagip dito sa may bandang northeastern part ng ating bansa. Ano nga ba yung naasaan natin dahil sa papalapit na bagyong si Egay? Sa ngayon, wala pa itong direktang epekto sa anumang bahagi ng ating bansa, no? Pero simula sa linggo ng umaga hanggang Lunes ng umaga, posibleng makaranas ng mula 50 hanggang 100 mm of rain sa Catanduanes at Northern Samar. Samantala, sa patuloy na paglapit nitong bagyo sa ating bansa, posibleng mapag-iba yung habagat na siyang magdudulot naman ng mga pag-ulan dito sa western section ng Mimaropa at Bisaya simula po sa Linggo, at sa Lunes at Martes ng Martes naman, posibleng makaranas sa mga pag-ulan na dulot ng habagat sa western section ng Southern Luzon at Western Visayas. Kaya ngayon pa lamang po nag-aabiso na tayo sapagkat bagamat malayo yung mga weather system, pwede pa rin palang maapekto sa ilang bahagi ng ating bansa. And then kung makakaranas ng mga pag-ulan yung ilang lugar sa mga susunod na araw, nandiyan pa rin po yung mga pagbanta ng pagba, lalo sa mga mababang lugar, at yung mga pag-uho ng lupa, lalo po sa mga areas na malapit sa mga gilid ng mundo. So sa mga kababayan po natin, manatiling nakatuto, and kung makikita nila sa mga succeeding bulletin natin, na yung lugar nila ay posibleng direktang maapektuhan, makipag-ugnayan po sa kanilang local government at saka local DR officials para sa mga disaster preparedness and mitigation measures. Samantala, isang example lamang ng atmospheric model na guidance nating mga forecaster in terms of ano nga ba yung nasa nating paulan. Simula ngayong hapon hanggang bukas, makikita natin minimal amount of rains. And then pagdating naman ng bukas ng hapon hanggang darating na Linggo, makikita natin yung dandang concentration sa western section ng ating bansa, no? Particular na dito sa may bandang Palawan, Western Visayas, at western section ng Mindanao. And then sa darating na Lunes naman, makikita natin, both sa concentration sa western part, magkakaroon din tayo ng mga possible rains dito sa Metro Manila, ilang bahagi ng Central and Southern Luzon area. And tandaan natin sa forecast track kanina, by Monday ay malayo pa rin yung bagyo sa kalupaan ng ating bansa. Pero dahil nga doon sa possible effect nito sa habagat, makikita natin yung pattern, rainfall pattern, ay nagiging consistent dito sa western section nga ng Southern Luzon, ng Visayas at ng Mindanao. So in terms of malakas na hangin, wala pa pong nakataas na tropical cyclone wind signal sa mga oras na ito. Pero during the course of Egay, ay posibleng ma-monitor natin or ma-record natin mga strong breeze to near gale force, hanggang 65 kilometers per hour na lakas ng hangin. Kung kaya hindi natin inirurule out yung possibility na posible tayong magkaroon ng unang warning signals dito sa ilang bahagi ng Bicol region at Eastern Visayas, lalo-lalo sa mga lalawigan sa silangang bahagi nito, simula po mamayang gabi or bukas ng umaga. Samantala, yung posibleng pinag-iba yung habagat naman, pwede rin magdulot ng malalakas na hangin na pwedeng magdulot ng mga occasional gusts dito sa may bandang Mimaropa, Western Visayas at western portion ng Mindanao, simula po bukas ng hapon. In terms of lagay ng pag-alo natin mga karagatan, sa darating na Linggo inaasahan natin magiging katamtaman hanggang sa maalo ng mga karagatan dito sa eastern seaboards ng Southern Luzon at ng Eastern Visayas. Kaya simula po Sunday, no, yung mga kababayan nating mangisda at yung mga maliit na sakim pandagat, kailangan maging maingat na. Kung inexperience po yung lalayag, as much as possible ay wag na po pumalaw dito sa mga seaboards ng eastern seaboard ng southern zone at ng Eastern Visayas simula po sa darating na linggo. At habang kumikilos yung bagyo si Egay, according to our forecast track, we're not also ruling out the possibility na magkaroon po tayo ng gale warning sa ilang bahagi, no, sa ilang seaboards, particular na dito nga sa silangan bahagi ng Luzon at ng Visayas. So patuloy po tayong magbibigay ng 6-hourly update hinggil sa bagyong si Egay. Ang susunod po nating tropical cyclone bulletin na ipapalabas naman mamayang alas 11 ng gabi.
That was Pagasa with an update on Tropical Depression Egay, which maintains its strength as it accelerates west-northwestward over the Philippine Sea at 20 kilometers per hour. It has maximum sustained winds of 55 kilometers per hour near the center and gustiness of up to 70 kilometers per hour. Now, it is forecast to intensify in the next 12 hours into a tropical storm. And throughout its duration in the PAR region, it may continue to steadily intensify and reach super typhoon category by late Monday or early Tuesday as it moves over the Philippine Sea east of Luzon. And in anticipation of possible strong breeze to gale force, wind signals may be hoisted in some areas of Bicol region and eastern Visayas, especially in the eastern portion, tonight or tomorrow morning. Now, areas that will not be directly affected by Egay, monsoon rains from the enhanced southwest monsoon are possible over the western section of Mimaropa and Visayas on Sunday. On Monday and Tuesday, monsoon rains are likely over the western section of southern Luzon and western Visayas. The Philippines' balance of payments position remained in a deficit in June as the national government settled its foreign debt obligations. Central bank data showed the balance of payments deficit narrowed to $606 million in June from the $1.6 billion gap in 2022. But month on month, the balance of payments widened from $439 million in May. Despite incurring a deficit for the last 3 months, the balance of payments position stood at a surplus of $2.3 billion in the first 6 months of 2023.
The second half of the year is shaping up to be a good period for the global IPO scene. During the first 6 months of 2023, global IPO volumes were down 5%, with proceeds dropping by 36% year on year. But SGV's Christopher Catalan said things are looking up not just for the Asia-Pacific region, but also for the local capital market.
In terms of expectation, it's quite rosy in terms of the global IPO trend. With the China government introducing some stimulus in their economy, it's expected that the second half is much better in terms of the Asia-Pacific. Those who are already disclosing that they intend to do public supposedly this first half of the year. Unfortunately, due to the market conditions, they deferred this IPO listing. But with the good economic fundamentals of the country, as well as the prospect of global activity, I think this will be deferred for the second half of the year or probably in the first half of 2024.
The Philippine Stock Exchange closed higher Friday to post its second weekly gain. More in this report.
Asian markets fluctuated on Friday following poor trading action on Wall Street. But Philippine shares bucked the regional downtrend. For today, the PSE index rose 0.5% to post its second weekly gain. Value turnover was also significantly higher at 8.5 billion pesos. Jovis Vistan, Vice President of AB Capital Securities, says the next catalyst will be second quarter earnings.
We are expecting some resistance at 6,700, but for us to break out of 6,700, I guess with regards to you mentioning what is lacking, I guess what's coming up, a picture of how second quarter earnings results perform, which would be coming out starting next week. We should see very positive earnings results in outside of banking, perhaps the utility companies, particularly the power sector, because of higher Western prices.
He adds consumer companies will benefit from a rebound in consumer spending. For Monday's State of the Nation address, Vistan says he wants to hear from the president plans about food security.
The important message that we can send also is how can fiscal and monetary policy be sustained? No? We've seen the last couple of years how great the presidents have done in terms of managing the economy, particularly in terms of maintaining low inflation and a stable exchange rate.
In corporate stories, Mega World sold 3.6 billion pesos worth of Emirates shares in an overnight placement at 13 pesos per share. The reinvestment plan detailing the use of the proceeds from the block sale will be submitted soon. UBS AG acted as sole placement agent for the transaction. In other news, Ayala-led Integrated Microelectronics and its partner Zero Motorcycles inaugurated this week its first high-powered e-motorcycle manufacturing assembly at the Laguna Technopark. The facility is projected to produce around 16,000 bikes per year by 2025. In the earnings stream, LPG firm Price Corporation posts 16% growth in first half net income to 820 million pesos, despite a 3% dip in consolidated revenues. This dip is attributed to the 26% drop in the average contract price. Helping offset this, a 9% increase in sales volume and better margins as households switch to branded LPG. Finally, Basic Energy Corporation adds another wind project to its portfolio, having received from the Energy Department the approved wind energy service contract for its Balayan Wind Power project. The Balayan Wind project is located approximately 1 kilometer east of Calatagan, Batangas. It's expected to initially generate and supply to the grid some 140 to 168 megawatts of capacity.
Sports now. The Philippine women's football team absorbed a tough 2-0 loss to Switzerland in their very first FIFA Women's World Cup match. The Filipinas yielded to Switzerland in their Friday afternoon match in New Zealand. Swiss players Ramona Bachmann and Serena Pubel scored the two goals for 20th-ranked Switzerland. This is the first time the Philippines has qualified for a senior FIFA tournament. The Filipinas will try to bounce back against host New Zealand on July 25, 1:30 p.m. Philippine time.
The much-awaited box office battle between the so-called father of the atomic bomb and the most popular doll in the world is happening. Our resident movie critic, Manny the Movie Guy, tells us what he thinks of Oppenheimer and Barbie.
Imagine a future.
The life of the so-called father of the atomic bomb, J. Robert Oppenheimer, is explored with Cillian Murphy playing the flawed but brilliant physicist.
Our film tries to take you into his experience.
Director Christopher Nolan combines physics and politics in bringing this story to life with his star-studded cast that includes Matt Damon, Robert Downey Jr., Florence Pugh, and Emily Blunt, among the many others.
We'll never get the best.
Jumping back and forth in time before and after the atomic bomb project, this film will pull you right in. No gimmicks, just good old-fashioned storytelling.
Why?
Even at 3 hours and with chock full of dialogue, Oppenheimer moves quickly. And in the end, I couldn't help myself but clap loudly with the audience. This is a must-see.
Five.
And for that, Oppenheimer gets 3.5 out of 4 nuclear arms race kisses. And to add some sun and fun in your life, check out Barbie.
Hi, Barbie!
Hi, Ken!
Say hi to one of the most anticipated movies of the year. It's inescapable, and for a film about a popular doll, this one has a lot to say.
The radio blast and goes.
The first live-action Barbie film based on the Barbie fashion dolls by Mattel has the fantastic Margot Robbie as our stereotypical Barbie and Ryan Gosling as Ken.
Well, I doubted my Kenergy. To be honest.
But doubt no more, because Gosling's Kenergy is to the roof. His signature song, Just Can't, should be nominated for Best Song at the Oscars next year.
I'm just kidding, where I see love, she sees a friend.
The crux of the film is Barbie questioning her existence. Yup, clutch your pearls. This one is about feminism, but it's not preachy. This will make you laugh and feel.
And then I hope they find themselves tearing up and choked up by the end.
Greta Gerwig brings her independent film qualities into directing Barbie, that characters and story matter over spectacle. Yet, the production values can be colored spectacular.
You can go back to your regular life, or you can know the truth.
From performances to direction, I am strongly recommending Barbie. Join her as she finds her place in a man's world.
Ideas live forever.
And for that, Barbie gets 3.5 out of 4. Life in Plastic is fantastic. Kisses. I'm Manny the Movie Guy for ABS-CBN News.
And before we go, catch a discussion about the advertising industry in the post-pandemic era on ANC's Business Outlook later at 8 p.m. We'll be speaking with Jem Alcantara and Jello Balingit of advertising firm Hakuhodo BCI.
Those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Dinsai.
And I'm Ron Crows. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thank you for watching. Now here's a quick roundup of news you need to know. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. says the Philippines is done with the International Criminal Court after Junk Manila's latest appeal. The chief executive heading for a state visit to Malaysia day after his second State of the Nation address on Monday. General Romeo Bronner formally takes his place as the new chief of staff of the Armed Forces of the Philippines. And Ukraine seeking the restoration of the Black Sea grain deal to avert another global food crisis. Those are the headlines. Keep it here on ANC.